the Lord regretted that he had made human beings on the earth, and his heart was deeply troubled. So the Lord said, I will wipe from the face of the earth the human race I have created, and with them the animals, the birds, the creatures that move along the ground, for I regret that I have made them. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. Let's look to God in prayer. Our Father, we come to yet another sad chapter in the book of Genesis. As we seek to deep into your word, we pray that our own hearts would be spiritually instructed and obey to the warnings that is here for us. This we ask it in Jesus' magnificent name. Friends, if you are there enough to surf the internet to find a listing of the top 10 natural disasters, sure enough, you found such a list. List includes natural disasters like cyclones, hurricanes, tsunamis, earthquakes, floods, famines, and storms. But after studying our present text, no such list could be complete without including Noah's flood in the number one spot. You know why? All these disasters were all local in nature. But in Genesis, it describes a vast flood that covered the entire earth. As you try to think about a flood of that magnitude, of mind-boggling, I'm sure one question keeps floating to the surface and again in your mind. Why would God do such thing? Why would God do such thing? Friends, in order to answer that question, let's jump into our today's lesson. So here is our outline, the rise of sin, chapter 5, 1 to 6, 1 through chapter 6 till 7. And the second division, the response to sin. The rise of sin, the response to sin. Friends, as we have seen in the previous lessons from Genesis, there was a rapid spiritual degeneration after the first sin. One sin entered the human bloodstream, but now, with the passing of the new generation, the entire world has become a cesspool of sin. This is the written account of Adam's family line. Friends, this is not the first time we have come across a statement like this in our study of Genesis. Book of Genesis contains 11 accounts, and it is organized accounting these 11 accounts, starting from the creation story. And if you believe these accounts, it will help you to understand the world better and the word of God better. And also, throughout the book of Genesis, you will see the word, the account of 10 times. And we have already finished the heavens, the account of the heavens and the earth and the Adam line. Today we begin the account of Noah. So let's go back to the opening verse of our scripture reading. This is the written account of Adam's line. Notice the word written account. Unlike other 10 accounts, this is the only section you will see the words written account. Telling us what? Telling us at the time of Adam, already there is writing and the advanced speech. And contrary to what evolutionists will say. And when God created mankind, he made them in the likeness of God, He created them male and female and blessed them. And he named them mankind when they were created. Here, we see a summary of when God created man. And there is another hint here that the beauty of the marriage and the blessings of the bond between the male and the female, uniting and becoming one. And they were named mankind because all came from the man Adam. Now look at verse 3. When Adam had lived 130 years, he had a son in his own likeness, in his own image, and he named him Seth. Friends, he had a son in his own likeness, in his own image. This stands in contrast to the image of God when man was originally created. Because of the fall, Adam had become corrupted. Consequently, all of Adam's descendants, including Seth, inherited this image. Friends, because of sin, we all fall short of the glory of God. After Seth was born, Adam lived 800 years and had other sons and daughters. Altogether, Adam lived today a total of 930 years and then he died. Adam died. This is the first natural death recorded in the Bible. Do you know what we see in the death of Adam? We finally see the physical fulfillment of the death sentence pronounced upon a man. God has warned Adam not to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For when you eat of it, you will surely die. So, the death of Adam has something totally new in the experience of man. Now, let's get into the genealogy. As we study this genealogy, remember that it is, first of all, an accurate historical account of the generations from Adam to Noah. It joins the story of Adam and Eve with the story of the Noah and the flood. And here is a pattern that we follow here. When Seth lived, he became the father of Enosh. After he became the father of Enosh, Seth lived 807 years and had other sons and daughters. Altogether, Seth lived a total of 912 years, then he died. Again, when Enosh had lived 990 years, when Canaan has lived 70 years, when Zareth has lived 160 years, and then he died. So, this is the pattern for most of this chapter. That is, when X lived number of years, he became the father of the Y. And after he became the father of Y, X lived the number of years and had other sons and daughters. And in the third step, altogether, X lived a total of number of years and then he died. 10 faithful men. When we come to verses 5 to 32, we find a genealogy of 10 men, starting with Adam and ending with Noah. The 10 generations cover a period of 1,650 years. Thus, this chapter spans the time from creation to the flood. And it is a record of 10 men. These are the godly descendants of Adam who lived by faith in a time of increasing unbelief. And in contrast to the Cain who founded the secular civilization, these 10 men stand before us as the giants of the faith. Men who refused to follow the prevailing cultural trends of their day. 10 generations, 10 men lived by faith, 10 fathers who made sure their sons caught the faith and then passed it along to the next generations. That is the whole life of faith in a nutshell. Friends, if the list in Genesis chapter 5 was extended, would your name be there on this list? May God help us to run the race with endurance so that we can pass the baton of faith along to those who come after us. Now, let us see some of the high points of this genealogy. Number one, death reigns. This is repeated 8 times in this chapter. Adam lived and he died. Seth lived and he died. Enosh lived and he died. Canaan lived and he died. This list is like a monotonous drumbeat of death. Across the generations, all the rest lived hundreds of years and then they all died. No matter how great these patriarchs were, no matter how faithful they died, no one could escape the power of death. Death reigned over all men. Friends, man is mortal. That is the message here. So don't miss the point. Death reigns. Death reigned in the earliest generations of world history, and death still reigns today. Next, Enoch, the man who walked with God. But even here, in the middle of this long list of names, we have an indication that death need not have to the last word, because but God. Notice the contrast here. In the line of Seth, Enoch is the 7th generation of Adam through Seth, and then through the line of Cain, Lamech, that is back in chapter 4, is the 7th generation of Adam, and so forms a contrast. So here is someone who actually loves God and has a fellowship with God. And verse 24, Enoch walked with God, and then he was no more because God took him away. So what did you spot in verse 24? Enoch stands out in the list of names because he is the only man who did not die. This breaks the pattern. He lives only a short time compared to the others, but this was not a sign of God's displeasure, but of God's grace. Consider the testimony given about him in Hebrews 11:5. By faith, Enoch was taken from this life, for before he was taken, he was commended as the one who pleased God. Notice here the two phrases that stuck out. Genesis says he walked with God, and Hebrews says he lived by faith and was commended as a man who pleased God. A person who walks with God is also a person who pleases God. So what does it mean to walk with God? Friends, walking with God means joining God in his purposes and in his plan, because it involves time, it requires listening and paying attention, and it is pursue holiness with him. You cannot walk with God and still play with the sin. The longer you walk with God, the more distance from sin you will be. That's why Jude reminds us that Enoch was a creature of righteousness who declared the truth of God to an ungodly generation. If he walked with God, no such moral darkness we can do. See, that's what it means to walk with God. He leads and we follow. Any other plan is bound to fail. Dear friend, which road have you chosen? Because we desperately need more Enochs in our world. Enoch was a man who stood out in a corrupt world because of his character. So I want to be said about me. I hope that's what you want said about you also. Next, the high point is Lamech's prayer. You see, there is another contrast which appears in verse 28. Please note, this is a different Lamech of Seth's line. and stands sharp in contrast to Lamech of Cain's line. It is the final name. And notice this list is Lamech. He named him Noah and said, he will comfort us in the labor and the painful toil of our hands caused by the ground the Lord has caused. Friends, what a contrast with other. The Lamech of Cain's line was a boastful, arrogant, and violent man. But the Lamech of Seth's line was a man of faith who believed and through his son would come some deliverance from the curse of God put on the ground, as in Genesis chapter 3. As a godly father, he looked into the future and saw that somehow his son would be used to comfort people and bring deliverance. Friend, that is the kind of people God is looking for and will help. And so, any deliverance is to come, it must be from God. Now, Noah was 500 years old. He became the father of Shem, Ham, and Japheth. You see, as Genesis chapter 5 comes to an end, we see how the line now narrows to one man, Noah, and to his three sons. Thus, we see the faithfulness of God to preserve the line of salvation, even in perilous times of rebellion and widespread of unbelief. Now, the people who walked away from God, friends, there is a saying, before things get better, they get worse. You see, sons of God, daughters of man, Nephilim, heroes of old, men of renown. After the detailed record of Adam's lineage, we see that a problem arises in the first 7 verses of chapter 6. And we see these unfamiliar and mysteriously named characters. Since we do not have enough time for more details, I encourage you all to read this week's notes who these characters are. But regardless of these characters are, the wickedness was so empowering that we read stunning words in chapter 5. The Lord saw how great the wickedness of human race had become on the earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time. And as bad as this, it is the heart of God that is truly difficult to read in verse 6, because verse 6 tells us the Lord regretted that he had made human beings on the earth and his heart was deeply troubled. So verse 6 tells us that God regretted making humans. What humans were doing were grieving God's heart. Friends, this is another picture of the heart of God. God loves his creation. God loves humans. God loves them so much that seeing their extreme wickedness broke his heart. The world is full of wickedness and it hurts God very much. So now there is only one option left. Since people do not want to walk with God and live as a people who bear his image. Now you see that God responds in verse 7. So the Lord said, I will wipe out from the face of the earth the human race that I have created, and with them the animals, the birds, and the creatures that move along the ground, for I regret that I have made them. Friends, it is what the theologians call the total depravity. God will wipe out humanity from the face of the earth along with all the animals of creation. The world is doomed, and rightly so. judgment should come across all the earth. No one is doing right. No one is walking with God. The result is the wiping of clean of the earth of its universal wickedness. So here is our first principle. The wages of sin is death, and God keeps his word in judgment and in salvation. The wages of sin is death, and God keeps his word in judgment and in salvation. So, dear brothers in Christ, we are reminded in this division, the result of sin is always destruction. The phrase, "and he died," that should really sober us, because we need grace. Grace is available through Jesus, the lineage of Seth, the image of God, the Son of God, the one who will give us relief from the curse of our sins. Friend, what will be your legacy when you stand before the Creator and give account for your life? Did you follow Cain and his descendants? Or did you follow Seth and his descendants? Or did you follow the Satan? Or did you follow Jesus? Friends, we all need grace. Let us live for and leave a legacy of grace. Yes, now let's move into our second division. The response to sin. So in our last division, we have seen the earth is corrupt, and God declares that he will wipe out the creation because of this corruption. And a judgment must come because no one is fulfilling the God's given purpose. But there is one silver of hope. Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. When sin was at its peak, we read that Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Friends, we need someone to gain God's favor to bring us from rescue. That's a great encouragement. It means that in spite of the corruption, the horrible violence, immorality, and the degradation around us, God's grace for the individual still shines through. What Romans 5:20 says, where sin abounds, grace abounds. Friends, no matter how terrible your sin, you can find grace if you will turn to the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus did not come to save the righteous, but to call sinners to repentance. This is the account of Noah and his family. So again, these words marks the new section in Genesis. And this is the third account. God selects a man named Noah to be the one who survives. So, notice what the biblical account does and does not say about Noah and how God chose him. Verse 9, now Noah was a righteous man, blameless among the people of his time, and he walked faithfully with God. So, Noah is different. Noah is described like Enoch. Noah walked with God. He is righteous and blameless man. Noah is set apart from the rest of the world. Rather than following the inclination of his heart and continually doing evil like the world, Noah walked with God. It was repeated 2 times. In a word, Noah's life showed consistency. Friend, can people say the same thing about you? do the people you work with, the people you spend time, see you as a person who is consistent? Otherwise, the language you use, the way you handle the conflict or people who hurt you, the way you respond in times of hardship, or your leisure activities, engaging in parties, drunkenness, law breaking, gossip, watching, reading, or doing things you know are inappropriate. The way you organize your time, studying God's word, worshiping God, praying to Him, or whether you are too busy with the most important things of this world. Friends, here the point is this. The world was watching Noah, and it is watching us also. We must live in a way that is above reproach. Now, God sees the earth corruption. So listen to verses 11 to 12. Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight and was full of violence. God saw how corrupt the earth had become. For all the people on the earth has corrupted their ways. God saw. When he looked down from heaven, the whole earth was corrupt in God's sight. The earth has deviated from God's design. It was corrupted by the sin of man and filled with violence. So, in light of man's condition and Noah's faithfulness, God comes up with a plan. The plan is to start over. Listen to the text. God said to Noah, I'm going to put an end to all people, for the earth is filled with violence because of them. I'm surely going to destroy both, destroy them and the earth. In other words, God is going to destroy the earth that man has already destroyed. Man has destroyed the earth with his sin, and God is going to destroy the earth and everything in it with a flood. So, verse 14, make yourself an ark of cypress wood. God told Noah a plan to carry out, in which he and his family will survive the flood. And according to his instructions, the ark was to be designed with two things in mind: to hold as much as possible and to be stable, because the ark was designed for capacity and floating stability rather than for speed. And there is some debate on exactly how large the ark was. So I have put together some graphics to show the footprint of the ark. See, you have seen the ark was 450 feet long. If you see today's 747 Boeing, it is 231 feet. And our popular the Titanic ship, that is 882 feet. And Noah's ark, it has a volume of 13,96,000 cubic feet and has a gross tonnage of 13,600 tons. That means, you know what is the gross tonnage, the capacity? It will carry 522 railway wagons, and capacity 1,28,280 sheep sized animals. So constructing a boat this large would have been a massive undertaking. Friends, think about what this means for Noah in terms of his obedience to God. It likely meant intense ridicule from the people all around, and it likely meant being marginalized by the world around him. It meant years and years of faithfully carrying out the work of the Lord had given to him. And it meant a huge investment of time and energy and possibly money to carry out the work. Friends, genuine faith works at continual obedience to the Lord, even in times when you doubt or start to get tired or discouraged. Faith means trusting what God has said more than our ability to understand. Friends, Noah is a picture of great faith. One should strive to imitate him. Now, why did God tell Noah to build the ark? And till now, all that we know is that God was going to destroy the earth and wipe out everybody out. But he tells more to Noah. I'm going to bring floodwaters on the earth to destroy all life under the heavens. Every creature that has the breath of life in it, everything on earth will perish. God tells Noah to build the ark because he was going to send a flood to destroy everything. All life would cease in the flood. All people, all animals, all plants would be wiped out. And God was going to wash the earth clean and start over. And in verse 18 to 21, God continues to tell Noah, "But I will establish my covenant with you. And you will enter the ark, you and your sons and your wife and your sons' wives with you." Verse 18 introduces a new word to us, the word covenant. This may be the first use of the word in the Bible. So what is that? Well, the context is that of salvation, that is, rescue from judgment. So it may be taking us back to the promise of God made to the woman in chapter 3, verse 15. The God would ensure that a descendant of the woman would defeat God's enemy, the serpent, and to bring the world under God's loving rule. Well, that can't happen if everyone is to be wiped out, can it? So, in the face of this perishing of mankind, God puts his covenant into effect through Noah, bringing him and his family to the ark. Now, at the end of the passage, verse 22, Noah did everything just as God commanded him. A few simple but profound words here. What does Noah do? Because Noah walks with God. You see, Noah do everything just as God commanded him. You know, and Noah did all the, verse 5, Noah did all that the Lord commanded him. In fact, this is a key statement. Four times we are told that Noah did all that the Lord commanded him. Friends, this is an important message being given to us. Those who walk with God do precisely what God says to do. Those who walk with God do not alter or argue with God's words. Those who walk with God do exactly what God says to do. Friend, in the midst of wicked and perverse generation, Noah obeyed. And Noah shows us how God's covenant children are to live, by grace and by faith. Noah did everything just as God commanded him. Now, the question is, what Noah does not do, Did you spot it? Noah does not speak. There is not one word of Noah which is recorded till the end of chapter 8. The one who does all the speaking is God. Noah just does, because the real hero here is the Lord himself. He takes the initiative in judgment and he takes the initiative in salvation. God is the one who is superintending everything. He lovingly takes care of his man and family. And verse 6. Noah was 600 years old when the flood waters came on the earth. So as Noah ticks over to his 600th birthday, the time to enter the ark arrives. And Noah and his sons and his wife, sons, entered the ark to escape the waters flood. So do you realize what this actually means? This not only means that Noah entered the ark, but Noah also left the world in which he has lived for 600 years. You know, they left behind their wealth. They left behind their friends. They left behind their family, their way of life, their homes. And so they embraced a new life, a life with God. Verse 15, pairs of all creatures that have breath in life then came to Noah and entered the ark. Did you catch that? The animals and the birds and insects will come to Noah. Noah did not have to catch them or trap them or round them up. No fear of man, just simple obedience to God. Verse 16, the animals going in were male and female of every living thing as God commanded Noah. Then the Lord shut him in. Once Noah and his family and the animals were inside the ark, do you know what God did? God shut them in. God shut the door, the single door, in the side of the ark. Once, friends, that door was shut by God, no one could leave the ark. And once that door was shut by God, no one else could enter it. Once God shuts the door, not even the gates of hell could prevail against it. God's electing grace shut the door. God's electing grace brought Noah and his family into his presence and new life and new salvation. In verses 11 to 12, on that day, all the springs of the great deep burst forth, and the floodgates of the heaven were opened, and the rain fell on the earth 40 days and 40 nights. Now what happened? Once Noah was shut in the ark of God, two things. The springs of the great deep burst forth, and the floodgates of the heavens were opened. And it rained in 40 days and 40 nights. And verse 20, the waters rose and covered the mountains. Verse 20 records that the flood waters rose over all the earth, covering all the high mountains. And verse 23, every living thing on the face of the earth was wiped out. Friends, what a sad words. Everything that moved on the earth died. And the waters flooded the earth for 150 days. Friends, do you see what happened? The earth returned to its original state and was once again covered with the water. The earth was covered with water for 150 years. You see, only Noah was left and those with him in the ark. Every living thing on the face of the earth was wiped out except for Noah and those with him in the ark. Friends, finally, in this chapter, notice that God does not remove Noah and his family from the judgment that was going to come. And God does not raise this family to somewhere in the heavens and then return them to the earth after the flood. They too must endure the judgment, but God will ensure they were not destroyed. Friends, someday we too will endure judgment. That is the final judgment of God. Like Noah, we can rest assured we will not be destroyed because God provides a means of escape, namely the cross and the grave of Christ. So here is our final principle. God justly judges all wickedness, but also extends saving grace. God justly judges all wickedness, but also extends saving grace. So, dear beloved, what a lesson for us this week. God shows us something of his character here. God shows himself both as a God of mercy and God of judgment. Noah and his family experienced God's mercy. They were not perfect by any means. So, salvation was not anything they earned or deserved. Their salvation was purely by God's grace. Then the Lord shut him in. Do you see what God's mercy does time and again? God's mercy provides a door of safety in a time of judgment. Friends, a judgment is coming. Those inside the door will be kept safe, and those outside the door will face judgment. Friend, which side of the door are you? Jesus says, I am the door. Jesus is the door of safety in the time of judgment. It is Jesus who alone saves us and able to save us. Let's look to God in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this wonderful, at the same time, a sad chapter for all of us to learn our lessons. Lord, help us to walk with you like Enoch, like Noah, wherever you lead us. Lord, move every person's heart here tonight so that we could be able to join the godly line, the line of faith, so that we would live in the light of eternity. Lord, bless this evening, bless our families. We ask all these things in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So thank you, friends. Class is dismissed. We are going to meet next week. Thank you.